All right, good afternoon again, everybody. So we guys get started with the last section of presentations. We got 4 half-hour presentations to take us up through the end of our intro day. So we're going to start with Tim O'Shea. I've asked him to talk about different concepts in how to use Gate Radio for exploring, visualizing, interacting with data, which I think is a huge part of us getting started and learning this type of stuff. This is fine, I think,
as long as I don't need to hold it.
Okay.
Let's just ask the strong
guy. Alright, so I'm going to talk about exploring data, and this is like an introductory tool, largely to visualizing data and signals in Gate Radio. I think we'll go into some more detail later in the week in kind of newer, more advanced methods, but this is kind of going to show you a lot of the tools that are there and how to use them quickly to start looking around at the spectrum and looking at signals. Alright, so there's kind of two classes, and I think this was edited while I stepped away, so that's fine. But there's streaming. Basically, it comes down to streaming and non-streaming tools for looking at signals and looking at radio data. So inside Gate Radio, we have the Qt GUI widgets are kind of the primary plotting tools. We've also had the WX GUI widgets, which are still there and a valid way to look at things. Both of those now have the ability to do the triggering and kind of sorts of techniques that you would expect to see on a standard oscilloscope, as well as various time frequency or spectrogram plots that you would hope to see to look at different views of the data. So there's also full-up tools like GQRX, which are kind of tailored to help you do kind of spectrum surveys, look for interferers or amateur bands, that sort of thing. And then there's a set of tools that comes with Gate Radio that I think a lot of people may not know about. They're called these like GR operation plot and then the type. So like GR spectrum plot C is a command line tool for just looking at a static file as a spectrogram stored in complex flow. And then there's this other tool for looking at them, looking at large files without reading the whole thing into memory. And I'm not going to go into that much today, but we'll talk about that more later in the week. Alright, so a shameless plug. In case you haven't seen all of the Hewlett and Virginia Tech propaganda that's already all over, we are hiring people for Arlington and Blacksburg, so anyone who's interested in graduate school, postdocs, full-time employment as a research scientist, or otherwise, come talk to us. We're hiring. Anyway.
You'll have a mean boss.
We do. Yeah, Bob is horrible. Sometimes. All right, so we've got our two plotting widgets, Qt GUI and WX GUI. FileSync is, of course, a valid way to look at streams. You can just write them out to a file and use your favorite analysis tool on disk. And then there's a tag debug. So in streams, we have this notion of tags, which follow along in the stream as a specific sample. And this allows you to view them when they occur in the stream. And then for message analysis, there's a number of tools here. So the GRQT GUI that's in Trunk is starting to be enhanced with message support so that you can look at messages of samples and not just streams of samples. There's my out-of-tree repo called GRPyQT, which is like a parallel set of plotters to do message-based plotting. There's the message debug, which is basically just a print. Like if a message comes along, you can print it out for diagnostics to see what message was coming along. And then there's GRPCAP, which is another out-of-tree module where you can basically take a message in Gate Radio and write it into a PCAP file. So it's very useful for like if you want to pull something from Wireshark. So just to step back, just so everyone's clear, when I refer to stream and message connections, in GRC, you've got these solid lines, which are stream ports. So like here, I have a sine wave going into a null sync. It's this extreme operation. It just keeps running continuously. There's a continuous stream of samples that keeps flowing. And then here, we have a message strobe, which produces a single finite message every 1 second and sends it to this message debug. So these are kind of the two primary mechanisms in Gnu Radio, and I think they've been talked about already today, but just to kind of put this context, these are the two primitives you work with, and the dotted line is the primary indicator. So getting to these tools is pretty simple. It can be hard to find things, but if you just type GUI in this little search box, you get this wonderful list of all of the Qt GUI and WX GUI widgets, which you can drop into a application very quickly from GRC. The simplest waveform that you could really put together to start looking at some live over-the-air spectrum is this. So you're basically going to take a USRP source block and run it straight into this Qt GUI sync block. So this is like the simplest thing you can do, and it's actually pretty powerful. This is, you know, a standard spectrum analyzer in many ways, other than the fact that you have no feedback to tune your and Qt GUI sync has a number of tabs with the different displays that we'll show in a minute. All right, so GQRX is another tool where basically it provides the spectrogram and a nice interface for you to tune around and basically look at, you know, what's in the spectrum. And so this occurred earlier today. Certain things appear in the spectrum you may not expect. And then lastly, Sylvain's awesome tool that we all love, GR Phosphor, is another out-of-tree module for looking at spectrum that provides this frequency view and a spectrogram. And this is a really great tool for doing rapid analysis of very short bursty stuff, because it's very good at rendering this fine time resolution without dropping samples. So those are kind of some of the primary stream analysis tools that are out there to work from. And then lastly, you know, the file sync. So many people will operate this way. If you simply record something to a file, you have any number of ways you can work on it offline to go back and have repeatable experiments and tests and just capture data to do your offline analysis on. And so this is just an example of running a USRP source into a file sync block. Another simple flow graph. And so once you've done that, there's these tools. So again, this is this GR Spectrum Plot C tool running on a captured LTE waveform. And so if you look, you know, we basically have this tool where we can scroll around in time in the signal and fiddle with the FFT size and the way that we're rendering the spectrogram. So this is a nice way to be able to just quickly look at what you've captured and get a feel for what's in it. And OFDM is always interesting in a spectrogram to see where all the block and resource block allocations are going in some channel. And so this is stuff that comes with Gnu Radio. It should be installed to your bin path if you've installed Gnu Radio. But I don't think there's yet a good like GRC interface or anything for it. So yeah, it's good to know that these exist sometimes. And then lastly, I'll talk about this more tomorrow, but this is just an alternate look at doing kind of final analysis using messages primarily instead of the stream base. So in this case, we only load little portions of a large file at a time, so you can handle, you know, big files, multi-gigabytes or terabytes, without destroying your computer. All right, so with that, I'm going to move on to the kind of exercise portion and just show kind of some of these things live that we've discussed here. So simplest here is, is this readable-ish? Okay, excellent. So we have here our USRP running into a waterfall sink. And let's go. All right, so actually let me do screen mirroring if I can to make this easier. it's not going to work. Okay. Okay, so Qt provides these widgets called a Qt range widget. And so in GRC, you have these variables, right, which just hold a value that can then be populated through some name into another block. And so a Qt range widget simply allows you to have kind of an interactive variable that can be changed at runtime. So if we name this guy FC, and then let's put him at 900 megahertz, go from 100 to 2.5 gigahertz. And then we can put that in as the center frequency here. And this is just kind of for display purposes. We'll tell the plotter where it looks. So we've now created a simple receiver plotter that we should be able to tune around using this range widget. So this is kind of like just building your own simple little GQRX right out of GRC, right? So this is kind of the first thing you might do when you're looking at some signal over here. So Wi-Fi is a little more interesting because it's very bursty. So we get to see some kind of temporal nature here. So if we put a max pull and make this a little wider, this is a very short, we're only plotting 1,000 samples at a time at 25 mega samples. So this is a very short time window. We might want to up that to, let's say, 1,000,000. So now we've got our Wi-Fi burst traffic in the room flying across in time here. And we can start to do some cool things. So Tom has added this wonderful control panel for us, which was missing for many years, and the gripe of many people who love WXQT, but it is now here and does work. So it's a very useful tool. So I can now turn on triggering and raise the level up. And so here now, basically, I can always trigger right on the beginning of the Wi-Fi burst. So I can start to kind of look around at what's happening, what's going on in the air, very easily. Zoom in. Keep zooming in.
The number of samples that they correspond to both plots are just the one on.
That was just the top one. So yeah, we could do the same down here. If we change the FFT size up to 496, turn on averaging. the problem with averaging is that this is a burst signal, so you may be averaging on time with off time. And the other thing is, if you look at this, they don't, all the bursts don't look the same, right? So we've got a combination of 802.11b, A, G, N, well, not A, but G and N, all sitting here, which all have kind of different power profiles. And so the spectrum for each one will look a little different. For the 11b, you'll see the direct sequence spread cycle and roll off differently from the LFP.
Can you use the top trigger for the bottom plot?
So I don't think that right now there's a way to do cross-triggering like that. So once you start getting into more of the message-based operations, that's exactly the sort of thing that we want to be able to do more easily in the future. And there is some stuff I'll talk about later in the week where this triggering operation, there's also a way to do this with event stream to extract chunks like that, but I'm not going to go there right now. All right. So if we want to get a better look at some of this data rather than just this stream, and we're overflowing a little bit, but that's fine for now. Not critical signal here. So if we just throw in a five sync, now we're going to write out to temp gr con. So we see we have this file now, which is called grcon. We've collected 700 megs of data in that like couple seconds. So sample data stacks up pretty quickly, as I'm sure anyone who's worked with this stuff before has realized. So we've got this tool now called grspectrogramplotc, and we can just give it. Look through and see what it looks like. We were off tuned a little bit for one of the channels. This over here. What? Yeah. So there's whatever fun ISM tools everyone has here. All right. So there's other tools. So we can look at a grimplotc. And then we can kind of start looking at, you know, what are these
Can you trigger those fault catches?
Sorry?
Can you trigger those fault catches?
Based on
some threshold.
Yeah, so in, if you want, in Gui Radio, there's actually a, there's a squelch form. So, what's it called? Power squelch. So if you wanted, you could put this between the two, and then only catch, basically burst on time. And so if you had a low duty cycle channel and you didn't care about arrival times, you know, that would be a cheap way to do that. So this is a quick way to browse around. I'll show you just very briefly the other file tool. So, all right. So I think that's most of the stuff that I wanted to cover. So I'm curious if there's any other interests or requests or questions we can cover in the last couple of minutes here.
Tim, you were doing a lot of things with just a single click. Can you go back and forth between DB and linear and stuff like that with a single click, or? What things are really easy and what things start to get harder?
Yeah, so a lot of that stuff is built into the Qt GUI widget. So if I pull up this time plot again. So I know Tom has put a lot of work into this kind of...
Did I mention disable the menu on the static plot, so run through the line examples?
Okay. So we'll go back to these here. Spectrogram, and we've got our time here. So if you right click here, you get all these options. So we can semi-log Y, we might need an auto scale. But that's a little odd since we're going to zero repeatedly. So there's a lot of, so you can pull up the control panel and this gives you all the same triggering stuff utilities here. So this is kind of the main set of plotting tools for using stuff. Yeah, so that's actually a great question. So if you look in this time domain, actually let's add a, if we add a range block, we'll call this G for the gain, and we'll go 0 to 100. I think the gain on the usurp is actually like 0 to 73 or something, but it seems to change. With user. So we'll put the gain in there. Actually, what would be cool too is there's a histogram sync, which is very useful for this exact sort of thing. So if we look at a complex to mag, for instance, and then we stream the magnitude of the signal into the histogram. If you would expect, so for a non-flipping signal, you would expect to have kind of a nice tail on your amplitude distribution. So we accumulate. Alright, so if we... Alright, so you see, if we're at a really low gain, our histogram is really kind of centered at pretty low magnitude value. And we can, just visually inspecting this, we can see that our signal lives kind of here between plus and minus 0.05. Now, as soon as we start putting the gain on the perceived LNA up, we're eventually going to get into clipping. And I believe the max ADC value gets normalized to the floating point values of 1 and minus 1. So what you see is once this gets high enough, we're just saturating at 1 and minus 1. So the values don't go past that, even though our auto scale is on. We're just clipping right there. So if you look then at this histogram, you can see that we don't have this nice tail. One, we're really pushing a lot of our data right up against the max magnitude. And so it's pretty clear right here that we're at clipping. And you can kind of find some happy medium where you back it off enough that hopefully your the tail of your distribution is such that you know you have some percentage, very low percentage of your data that sits beyond clipping. So that's a really quick way to kind of figure out what gain level should I be using, and am I getting kind of the full dynamic range that I can out of the signal. Yeah, and this is visually, so, you know, maybe halfway to one, which is pretty good. I mean, you usually want to back off a bit. So our mean value of somewhere in here, 0.4, 0.3, which is great. This gets a little bit more complicated if you're looking at a burst signal, because you'll wind up with an on distribution and an off distribution. As instead of, since this is kind of constantly on, we get this nice, I think probably chi-square distribution here.
Okay, so I understand the data files is binary data. Are there any tools for associating metadata with those things?
Yes. It's a great question. Like you're feeding them to me. There's actually these file meta source and sync blocks, which are intended to store stream tags along with the sample data. And so the user by itself puts out some stream tags by default. So it spits out, I think, three tags, RX time, RX stream, and RX street, which tell you where you're tuned and what the time is. And so if we do a final meta sync, we'll call this temp gr2, and let's go back to the ISM band. So let's let you record anything we should.
All right, well, we're past time, but thank you for the questions, and thank you, Tim.